We call this meeting the Oskaloosa City Council to order. Today is Tuesday, January 3rd, 2017. Happy New Year. Let's start with the invocation by Pastor Paul Hoekstra, First Christian Reformed Church.
Let's pray together. Gracious Heavenly Father, you are the one from whom all blessings flow. You have created everything that is, and you sustain everything that is. And we thank you for that. We thank you for Oskaloosa. We thank you for these council members. We pray, Heavenly Father, that as they begin a new year and many deliberations, you will give them wisdom. You will give them insight. You will give them joy in what they do. And for the people of Oskaloosa, we pray that they will be supportive and that they too will receive a blessing from the work that is done. We pray, Heavenly Father, that there will be discussions, and those discussions will be fruitful, and that different points of view can be presented in a way that bring about clarity when action is required. And when there's disagreement, may there not be disagreeable actions. We thank you that people give their time and their energy. We thank you that people love their community. And we pray that this community will prosper and that your name will be lifted up. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ, who lives in our forever and ever. Amen.
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 Thank you, Pastor.
Yeah, thank you.
Could you join me in the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Roll call, please.
Burnett.
Here.
Dodger.
Here.
Jimenez.
Here.
Moore.
Here.
Bisset.
Here.
Walling.
Here.
Yates.
Here.
Okay, thank you. Moving on, next item is the opportunity for community comments. This item is reserved to receive comments from the community for concerns whether or not they're included on the current agenda. The community is encouraged to come and speak before the mayor and city council. We do ask to keep statements brief. Time would be limited to no more than 3 minutes. Any questions that are to be asked of the city staff, the council members, or the mayor, we ask that those be asked prior to speaking to the full council, so that way concerns can be properly researched and perhaps answered away from the meeting. Comments are to be directed to the mayor and city council only. Is there anyone who would care to speak at this time? Seeing none, we'll move on. Next item is the consent agenda. These items are routine in nature, will be enacted by one motion. Does anyone care to support the consent agenda?
Second.
Okay, any discussion?
I do have a couple of questions. I don't think I want anything removed. Is there anybody here that knows on the generator at the Northeast Wastewater? The gas line was supposed to be rerouted and not run under the new generator, and I'm just curious if that happened.
Yes, that was rerouted.
It's not underneath there. Thanks.
Correct.
Thank you, Chad. On N, it talks about if it exceeds the $1.9 million, there's going to be more cost, if I understand it. But if I read it, we don't expect it to exceed the $1.9 million.
Yeah. For folks in the audience, this has to do with approving an agreement with the Iowa DOT for funding on the D Street, South D reconstruction project. And so, this is talking a total estimated cost of the project is $1.9 million with 80% eligible for reimbursement. So what's the question you got?
Well, down in there then it says, but if it exceeds it, then there's more cost. And it doesn't really describe I don't think the grants covers that, so then we're going to pay everything that's over and above that, if I read it that right. And that's my question.
Okay.
Mayor and Council, what we have budgeted is the amount that we expect the project to be. If we have to, if we're faced with that situation where we have a higher cost amount, we could be unhooked for the additional cost, but we would also talk about the potential of amending the STP, the Surface Transportation Program, to fund additional portions of that. But presumably, since we're entering into contract, that would be the amount that we're working towards is the 1.9. So the idea is to stay under that.
Well, I think that's important that everybody realizes that.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah, if it exceeds that amount, we're going to pick up the tab. Is that correct, Mike?
With STP funds, and that's what I'm looking at, Akilish, if it's an eligible expense, I believe the DOT would allow us to use STP funds for, but we would have to amend our regional plan in order to the project at the regional level to accommodate that. So there is a potential that we could extend the 80-20, but with this project, we're borrowing ahead on those regional funds, which is allowed, but our intent is not to go over that at 1.9.
And everything else is included, the sanitary water?
It's in the budget.
It's all in there?
Yeah, it's in the planned rates.
Okay.
Anything else, Tom?
Yeah, give me a second.
Okay.
On the claims, just to make sure I remember it correctly, the city contribution to Forest Cemetery, the $50,000, that's a one-time deal for this year, right? I should say 2016.
It's $100,000.
So it's the second payment of the $50,000 for 2016.
And it's become an annual expense as the agreement that was written, approved by council. It's an annual expense as long as the funds are budgeted that way.
Okay.
I think we're in our third or fourth year of that.
Yeah, it seems like it.
Actually, it seems longer.
And the same, I'm sorry.
It seems longer, actually.
Wait until our budget retreat, then you'll really say that.
The same question on the Stevens Memorial Animal, the $37,250. Remind me again, how often do we pay that per year?
That's twice.
Thank you. And I believe the last one, I'm just curious, we're paying for sludge hauling. Did we get rid of our tractor, trailer, semi? I assume we're doing something that's smart, and I'm not questioning it. I'm just always curious.
The sludge hauling is for the equalization basins out at the plants. It's to remove the biosolids from those facilities. It doesn't have anything to do with
This is a maintenance, because we're trying
this
to get
is a
those.
Issue.
Yep, thank you, Chad.
Yes.
I think that's it, Mayor.
Okay. Does anyone else have any questions or comments? Okay. Roll call, please.
Ballinger?
Yes.
Jimenez?
Yes.
Moore?
Yes.
Thursday?
Yes.
Wallace?
Yes.
Yates?
Yes.
Burnett?
Yes.
Okay. That passes. Item 6, announcement of vacancies that we have on various boards and commissions. There's four of them here. The Airport Commission, we have one vacancy to fill. It's upon appointment for an unexpired term ending on December 31st of 2021. It's a five-member board meeting the first Monday of the month, four males and no females serving, one vacancy. Civil Service Commission, we've got one vacancy for a four-year term that begins April 1st of 2017 and ends on March 31st of 2021. It's a three-member board that meets as needed. We have three males and no females serving. Historic Preservation Commission, two vacancies for alternate members. It's a seven-member board with two alternate members that meets as needed. We have five males and two females currently serving with two vacancies for alternate members. And finally, the Municipal Housing Agency. We have one vacancy for a two-year term that begins on March 1st of 2017, ends on February 28th of 2019. It's a five-member board that meets on a quarterly basis. Currently, we have two males and three females serving. Into the regular part of the agenda, item 7A is to consider a resolution levying a special assessment against private property. It's owned by Melody Ann Cochran and Brian Holliday at 115 South M Street in Oskaloosa. That's for cleanup to abate a nuisance existing pursuant to the order of Mahaska County District Court. This is the time for the public hearing for levying the special assessment. A certified notice of the hearing was sent to the property owners, and notice of the hearing was published in the Oskaloosa Herald prior to this public hearing date. And so on June 24th, Mahaska County District Court, in case number EQEQ088031, entered an order and decree adjudging the conditions existing at the property located at 115 South M Street, and so ordering that the nuisance be abated. They said the decree further provided that in the event they should fail to do so, the city of Oskaloosa could abate the nuisance with costs to be assessed to the owners. The owners failed to abate the nuisance, and therefore the city caused the nuisance to be abated by the demolition of the dilapidated structure existing and the removal of the debris. The city clerk prepared an assessment schedule listing and showing the costs of the abatement, a copy of which is attached to the agenda here. I believe it came to $16,000 and some change. Yeah, $16,052. And then it also, being assessed to the taxes, it goes at a 9% interest rate. So I'll open the public hearing at this time. Is there anyone who would care to speak to it? Seeing none, I'll close the public hearing. Do we have a motion supporting the resolution levying the special assessment against Melody Ann Cochran and Brian Holiday for the property at South M Street?
So moved.
Okay. Any comments?
Do we consider this cleaned up now?
No.
Good. Because it looks terrible down there yet.
I would say, and just, I think everybody understands this, but the pictures that are included with the packet, which are up on our screen now, that is not during demolition. That is what existed on the property, which then caused us to use emergency abatement to then clean it up to the point where it's like this. But we still have a long ways to go with nuisance enforcement on that property as far as I'm concerned.
The old campers and stuff, are they living in those campers? Is that camper, or do we know?
Aaron, if I can speak to that, that's an interesting point of contention. We've been in court over that. He steadfastly maintains, no, I'm not living there, I'm just keeping tools there, and I'm over there during the day. Claims that he is not living there. I'm somewhat skeptical of those claims, but we've had a contempt hearing, and the court did not find beyond a reasonable doubt that he is living there. There are, however, some new independent proceedings relating to the property. There was some cleanup that was done, and they're actually working two different ends of it. The fire department is working one end, and my understanding generally is that, Mark, last time you looked at that, or the department looked at it, that it thought essentially the cleanup was fine, but we've still got issues, obviously, with the RV there. I have just earlier today, as a matter of fact, been drafting some additional things to be filed relative to that. So there are still some things in the works. This part, in fact, has been taken care of. I mean, the building has been torn down, the ground has been leveled, but you're right. When you drive by, it certainly begs the question, and there are certainly issues with it, so there are some things still pending.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, we've got a motion and a second. Any further comments? Roll call, please.
Jimenez?
Yes.
Moore?
Yes.
Jose?
Yes.
Wallen?
Yes.
Yates?
Yes.
Yes.
Caligari? Yes.
Okay, that passes. Item B, this is to consider a resolution scheduling a public hearing on the vacation of an unused section of the street right-of-way lying between 815 and 901 South F Street, and referring this request to the Planning and Zoning Commission. Tawny Jenkins, on behalf of the owner of the property at 815 South F Street, which is Russ Parker Enterprises, has requested that the unused street right-of-way adjacent to that property be vacated. Ms. Jenkins is also requesting that the street vacation application fee be waived and that Russ Parker Enterprises, LLC, be allowed to purchase the right-of-way for $1 plus the recording and transfer costs. This section of unused street right-of-way is 66 feet in width, 12,144 square feet in area, and is zoned R2, which is urban family residential. Alan Pierce, the owner of the other property adjacent to this unused section of street right-of-way, has expressed that if the right-of-way is vacated, he's not interested in purchasing his half. Vacation of the street right-of-way will not limit access to other properties, and there are no utilities present. Since this area of unused street right-of-way is similar in size and width to the surrounding lots in the area, Staff is recommending that it be vacated and sold as outlined in the Oskaloosa Municipal Code and adopted fee schedule of $1 per square foot. In the event this parcel is sold and then developed, a hindrance is that the minimum lot width allowed in an R2 zoning district is 70 feet. So a variance for a minimum lot width would need to be obtained from the future property, from the future property owner before a structure could be built on it. So the recommendation to the council is to refer this request to planning and zoning, schedule a public hearing on the vacation of the above-mentioned unused street right-of-way for January 17th of 2017. And staff has also recommended that the unused right-of-way section be vacated. So do we have a motion of support on this? And I would suggest that it be done to send it to Planning and Zoning Commission scheduling the public hearing.
So moved. Second.
Okay, any discussion?
Question.
It looks like there's buildings there.
Yeah.
Three buildings.
Mayor, council, there's a playset, like a play yard, playset there. I don't know if there is a garage there anymore or a shed.
Well, maybe it's an old picture, that's why I'm asking. There shows a garage up towards the south end.
But this is one of those, old projects that Marilyn Miller actually had a file in her desk. And she left her position, Amy came across it, and it was just like, what is this? And it was one of those unresolved files. And so we've been kind of working through why this parcel was never recorded in the first place, why is there something built, no, why is there a structure on it? And we had made contact with the property to the north, which is listed as 815 South F, before Mr. Parker owned it, telling them they need to get their structure off of the city's property. It appears, you know, it's true, they have since sold that property to Mr. Parker, and has interest in acquiring it, whether it be for enlarging the yard or for future expansion. We're not completely sure. I think he's expressed expansion of the yard.
Yeah.
Or the garage.
Right now, you're in a garage.
Or for the garage, or for the use of the playset or something.
So he's not claiming to own the building, if it's there. Will be his. Will be if we sell it to him, that's my point.
So do I read it that they're asking to buy it for a dollar, and we're telling them we'll sell it to them for a buck a square foot, which is $12,144?
Yeah, that's, because it's unused right-of-way, the council's adopted fee schedule is that. We, in the past, council's action on disposal of property, even to Habitat for Humanity, we haven't sold it for a dollar. They've at least charged, or paid $250. So, no, we don't recommend that it be transferred for a dollar. We recommend that it could be sold for more than that.
What's the idea behind sending it to planning and zoning?
It's a vacation of right-of-way, and so the city's code requires that it go to P&Z first, after council sends it to them, and then public hearings are held, and then ultimately council takes action on the recommendation from planning and zoning.
Okay, but if nobody else knew it was for sale, then what if somebody else wanted to buy that?
And so that's the thing, I would say that's a great question. One of the things that we were working on about a month and a half ago, was creating a policy to address vacation of property or parcels, but that got put on the back burner. And so I would say what Mr. Parker's doing is utilizing a process that exists within code. And so he's asking, hey, can I buy it? And so we're saying, sure, there's a process for it, and here's what it is. I would say in the future, we're trying to create a policy to address disposal of other parcels, properties that we acquire, like old houses. And so that council would have, we as staff would have formal direction from you going forward. The other thing about this is this property doesn't meet the minimum requirements for width. And so if it had been 70 feet, I would say absolutely, council, hold off. Let's put this thing out to bid because it's a development-ready lot. But because it's 66 feet and there are no guarantees that variances will be provided, that's why I think this would fit under the request to purchase right-of-way, essentially.
That's a lot of money to buy for a dollar.
Well, I'd say we put it on the market, try to sell it, not just...
That's what I would say.
Give it away. I mean, that's not going to... It's not like we're exactly flush.
And we don't know what he'll say to the dollar per square foot. No idea. I mean, I don't know that we'll get $12,000 for it if we sold it on the market, but the code at least outlines a process for handling it. It's a dollar per square foot. If he says, no, no thanks, then my recommendation would be, yep, let's make sure that we vacate this. Let's get it recorded as a lot, and let's put it out on the market. Again, there's no guarantees that it can be built on.
That's
because
right.
A variance is never a guaranteed thing unless you show a hardship. So if someone wants to take a risk on that, they could. But I would say let that be the case after this process runs its course as outlined in the code.
And so if Mr. Parker were to say, I'm not interested at the buck a square foot, but the public hearing would also shine a light that, hey, this is in place, so perhaps somebody else could get up at that point and say, I'd be willing to step in and, as a purchaser?
I guess it could. I would suggest that we'd actually put it out and accept sealed bids rather than what happened here with Mr. Durande and
Terry Anderson. Yeah.
That was, I think, not a very productive way of disposing of property. So that's why one of the reasons why we were working on that policy.
Okay. So we've got a motion and a second, sending it over to P&Z. Any further comments? Roll call, please.
Moore?
Yes.
Forsyth?
Yes.
Walling?
Yes.
Gates?
Yes.
Burnett?
Yes.
Belger?
Yes.
Jimenez?
Yes.
Okay, that passes. Item C is consider an ordinance amending the Oskaloosa Municipal Code, Chapter 13.08, Section 13.08.570A. This has to do with the user charges for the purpose of providing funding associated with operation and maintenance of the wastewater treatment works. First reading. The Sanitary Sewer Fund, or the Wastewater Department, is an essential service provided by the city, and this service is an enterprise and utility fund. As such, revenues generated through rates have to be spent on operating the utility. The budget over the last three fiscal years has emphasized an intensive investment in the system to address costly DNR mandated compliance improvements, approximately $11 million worth of requirements over the next three fiscal years alone. The FY 2017 and 2018 budgets include a financing and operating plan for the sanitary sewer system, requiring an increase to the base and usage rates that impacts the average residential ratepayer by approximately $6.50 a month, or the equivalent of $78 annually. The average residential customer uses a little more than 4 units of water per month and is charged a sewer base rate based upon a sewer base rate regardless of the usage. So we have a chart in here listing off the dates that we've done rate increases and what the minimum charge per month has risen by. As far as from the budget consideration, proposed April 1st increase is the third year of a multi-year increase plan that has been recommended for the Sanitary Sewer Fund. Increasing the rates as outlined in this agenda allows the city to meet current financial obligations associated with the operations of the city wastewater treatment works, including the DNR mandated improvements for such as inflow and infiltration, INI, and disinfection at 2 of the treatment plants. Funding also anticipates the utility's need to borrow $12 million from the state revolving fund to complete the projects within the DNR mandated compliance schedules. So it's no fun doing this, but do I have a motion for this first reading?
Salute. Second.
Okay, any discussion?
When's the date for the DNR mandate, do you recall the mandate date?
We have multiple dates for compliance.
Oh, okay.
One for disinfection is, remind me, guys. A couple of years from now. And then there'll be the INI, the inflow and infiltration, which would be the rainwater entering the storm sewer. We haven't received a compliance date yet because we haven't provided a plan just yet, so we'll submit that, work with them, but we can expect it to be 3 years or less, hopefully three. So that's again how we've built this particular utility fund capital improvement program. One of the things that I did want to mention to the person who made the council member made the motion a second, this item doesn't necessarily state it, I guess, very clearly, but I'd like to suggest that the effective date of the rate increase would be April 1 of 2017. Yeah, the ordinance itself says it would be effective upon the last date or the publication of it, but April would be my suggestion.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
That's
fine.
Okay.
Yes.
And it did say that in the budget consideration.
Oh, there it is, thank you.
It says April 1st.
Yeah. It just wasn't read, I'm sorry.
Any further comments?
When do you anticipate the borrowing of money? Is that gonna be right away, or what?
We would need to, we've already had discussions with our financial advisor about that. Yeah, we're starting that process now, pending formal approval of the rates. It's a multiple step process to get us into the SRF queue. You have to fill out documents, have program projects put together and submitted. So yeah, we're working on that now. The idea would be, and sorry, I'm kind of giving you kind of a pause there. The plan, as you might recall during the study session, just so the public understands that we have had multiple conversations about this, but during the study session, there was a discussion about a second bond issuance or borrowing occurring later. So there'd be a first one and a second one. We'd like to delay that pending, let's just see how projects go, timing, and how the rate the utility performs. Sometimes we end up seeing savings throughout a year, and so that second borrowing wouldn't necessarily need to occur right away. So
save us money.
That would be the idea, is not borrow unless we have to.
Other comments? Roll call, please.
Brisay?
Yes.
Walling?
Yes.
Yates?
Yes.
Burnett?
Yes.
Caligiuri?
Yes.
Jimenez?
Yes.
Moore?
Yes.
Okay, that passes. Item D. Consider a resolution approving a multi-year mowing and trimming agreement between the city and Four Seasons Yard Care. This item is a request from city staff to execute a three-year extension of services with Four Seasons Yard Care, providing mowing and trimming services at the city facilities. Contractors perform services to expectations and within cost estimates for the city. They were originally selected to provide mowing and trimming services as the low bidder through a formal request for proposal process in March of 2014. City Council approved a two-year contract extension for the 2015 and 16 seasons with a minor increase in cost. The proposed prices for all 3 years of the contract extension proposed with this item, that is covering 2017, 18, and 19 seasons, is still under the next closest bidder's total cost received during the 2014 RFP process. And that information is attached for our review in the packet. So staff is recommending approving the three-year contract extension with Four Seasons Yard Care, as noted below. And so they've got it spread out there as what's going to be in 2017, 18, and 19. So 2017 is the same. 2018 would be another $30 per mower across the board. And then 2019 would be another $40 per mower. I have a motion supporting it.
So moved.
Second.
Okay. Any discussion? Roll call, please.
Walling?
Yes.
Yates?
Yes.
Burnett?
Yes.
Caligiuri?
Yes.
Jimenez?
Yes.
Moore?
Yes.
Brisay?
Yes.
Okay, that passes. Item E. This is discussion, possible action on work associated with the repeal and replacement of the sidewalk ordinance 17.08.120. On November 21st of 2016, City Council passed by a vote of 4 yes and 3 no, the third and final reading amending the Oskaloosa Municipal Code, creating 17.08.120 required public sidewalk. There's some new language. The new language adopted is tucked into the packet here. However, upon further review of the adopted language, it's clear that the City Council cannot serve as an appeals board for rules and regulations that are specified in Title 17 of zoning of the Oskaloosa Municipal Code. The ability to hear appeals for items within Title 17 zoning is the responsibility of the City Council-appointed Board of Adjustment. As a result, staff is recommending the City Council repeal the current language and replace with satisfactory language. A couple of options that exist include deleting 17.08.128.3, having to do with the City Council standing for appeals, and then allows the appeals to be heard by the Board of Adjustment, or remove the appeal process to the City Council and the requirement for sidewalks to be installed in residential projects as well. So I'm going to skip over reading the ordinance as it stands now. The item has been placed on the agenda to outline the required process that has to be followed by the city to repeal and replace the current ordinance language within Title 17. We're showing on January 4. It's not necessarily required. It would be the Planning and Zoning Commission to discuss the adopted language for 17.08.20 and the need to repeal and replace. Then February 7, P&Z would hold a public hearing to repeal and replace the language, possibly taking action. February 21, City Council would consider item to schedule a public hearing on repeal and replacement as recommended by P&Z. And then on March 6, the City Council holds their own public hearing, considers action on the P&Z recommendation in the form of a first reading. March 20th, the City Council would consider the second ordinance reading, assuming that it passes on the first reading, to repeal and replace. And then April 3rd, the City Council would consider the third and final ordinance reading, presuming that the first and second passed, to repeal and replace. So it's just, I suppose, to give Council a sense of what kind of a timeline we're talking about, that these things take a while. Do we have any desire for action at this point, sending it over to Planning and Zoning for consideration?
With recommendations? Is that what you're looking for here on the recommendation to Planning and Zoning?
I think it'd be good to understand what might survive the council process. that's fair.
I guess I wouldn't mind seeing it going over here. We remove the appeal process and remove the sidewalk part in the residential. And the rest of it, I think, would be fine.
I'd support that.
Okay. Is that a motion, Tom?
Yes, it is.
Is that a second, Tom?
Yes.
Okay. Any discussion?
What?
Okay.
So we're making that recommendation to P&Z. Will they also get the other option to consider?
Yeah.
So we're going to say these are two options you can consider.
Yeah. Yeah, I think that's what we'd want to do. Again, the evolution of this item took the exact same steps that we just outlined. And it kind of morphed as council considered it. And obviously, I think, and I'll readily admit, in haste to maybe get consensus on an item, the appeal to the council was allowed, and so here we are. We're back at the drawing board. We want to make sure that P&Z again has a full consideration of the item from scratch. I do think it's good that they know that there's maybe a sense of a flavor from council about what might be supported. But I do think they'll continue to act as an independent group, as your advisors, essentially, to come up with their own recommendation.
My concern with voting yes to the motion as is somehow feels like we're backing up on trying to move forward with getting sidewalks in places where we need sidewalks.
Just start out by finding out where we need sidewalks instead of just coming up and just say arbitrarily saying, well, if you build a house there, you should put sidewalks in.
Certainly an option.
Let's talk about safety, for example. Like maybe the Walmart would be a good place to start. Maybe the Beacon Highway on 11th Avenue toward Edmondson Park would be a good place for a safety sidewalk. 15th Avenue East. Why don't we just talk about those locations instead of just saying arbitrarily, if you build a house, you got to put a sidewalk in. Wouldn't that be simpler?
Certainly is an option. Appreciate your input. I certainly want it to go back to P&Z. I certainly want their professional opinion on what we should do. I don't know that I want to feel like I'm dictating to them by a vote of yes that here's what I want them to do, is my concern with the motion. Or any recommendation. I'd like presenting them with options, but it's almost like saying you need to pass this so that we can then pass what you pass. That's it. Just seems like we're.
And perhaps when the mayor asked me a question, I didn't respond probably very well. I don't know that there was a need for any action on the item tonight. Put it that way, just in case something came out of it. In my mind, we have to repeal the item.
Absolutely. I don't disagree with, I don't disagree with that.
I don't know that the council has to necessarily refer anything back. I guess what I was looking for is let's try to vet some of the concerns. Let's get the concerns that council has out on the table so that when we as staff present to P&Z, we can try to frame maybe some of those concerns, what we learned, and then share that as part of the data collection and data sharing process to them. And of course, they're going to see this again for the second time. And I think they'll probably be pretty consistent on the recommendation, if I had to guess. They'll probably come back to you with a recommendation that it moves forward, general commercial, industrial. I still think there may be a push for residential. But I don't know how those conversations will evolve. But I don't know that there has to be a direction to them saying this is how it's going to be.
Well, yeah, and I expressed that opinion when I said what I said on this, is I we don't need to be in the appeal process. We don't need a piece of sidewalk in the middle of a block someplace 70 feet wide that we're not going to support by adding to that and continuing on with that sidewalk. And why would you make one person with a 70-foot piece of sidewalk right in the middle of nowhere put that in there and then say, well, you know, my neighbor should catch up with me? Well, that's not really the case. You know, just because he wants to build a new house or restructure the house that he has now by the percentage that they're using, why would you want them to throw a sidewalk in there and then make his neighbors want to shoot him?
Okay, but if we go ahead and vote on this motion, and then it's either pass or fail. And then if somebody wants to move the other way, we can do that again. And then they're just getting our input.
Mm-hmm.
The way I look at it, we aren't telling them what to do.
But I think, you know, you and I and I don't know, Aaron, were the concern was of putting that one piece of little sidewalk in the absolutely middle of nowhere. That's what we don't need to have happen. Unless we, the council, or the council in the future, is going to go ahead and put that sidewalk continuously through the rest of that block.
Yeah, and so if the item, let's say it comes back and the residential piece is still there, the appeal could be heard by the Board of Adjustment, and so there would have to be a proof of hardship, things like that. There's still a requirement, if it was to come back, that the council would look at that connectivity plan. So the idea that it may be the only one there today, but the council may allocate funding to proceed with either assessing or constructing.
And if the council doesn't, then what? Then this guy's sitting there with a sidewalk?
That's probably how it'd be.
Why would you want to do that? That's just nuts. If the council and the city is not going to support finishing that sidewalk out, well, that just looks dumb in the middle of that block. Makes zero sense.
So is that the argument for number one?
Well, I don't care about number one. It's going back to planning and zoning anyway. But we need to take care of that residential, the industrial, commercial. It's automatic. You know, that's going to go.
A point of clarification, and it's come up before in this discussion. Let's throw it out and start over. But is that going to take, this can take 5 months. Does that take 5 months to throw it out and start over? I'm just curious. I mean, that's a lot of steps, but I understand it's the process, but it would, I mean, it's not legal. So if we just, can we delete it tonight and start over and get it done before April 3rd, or is it going to take that long no matter what we do?
This is the process that will be required to delete and replace.
Okay, so it can't do anything.
Right.
No, we can waive the second and third readings and actually do it in 30 days. So, I mean, we can speed it up a little bit. Because we know we got something in the books, none of us want. So,
good point.
We at least have that option, I think.
I don't know that I've ever heard. Why is it different that we're treating industrial commercial different than residential? Why is it okay to have sidewalks to somewhere in front of industrial commercial, but not to have them in front of residential?
That's the policy question for council. I mean, we don't have it for any of them.
I mean, right, it seems now, like everybody's ready to sign off on the industrial commercial, but they're all against residential. I'm just curious what the difference is between the two.
Well, I'm going to sign off on both of them because look at the water department that we made our taxpayers put in to go nowhere. How many years ago was that? Are we shoveling that?
Yeah.
Hmm? Paying taxpayer money to shovel a sidewalk that shouldn't have been put in the first place. Now we want our customers, our residential people, to do the same thing. It's ridiculous, absolutely ridiculous. We don't need them either place. If there's no sidewalks there, don't put them in until you do the whole street.
In the active transportation plan, which I haven't seen because it happened before I got here, I'm a, what is, how much of this town is covered by sidewalks?
Steve, we can't hear you.
In the active transportation plan, it was done last year sometime in 2015. How much of the city is covered by sidewalks in that plan? That may be an unfair question.
Yeah, I don't know the percentage that, is covered. That plan did an inventory of all the sidewalks in the town. This fiscal year is the first year where funding was provided by city council to connect sidewalks to other places. That was done on Edmondson.
2016 was the first year to do that, right?
This fiscal year.
Yeah.
This current fiscal year 17.
I'm just clarifying.
Is the first year where we've actually had funding to start filling those gaps. I think, like I mentioned before, we've managed to make other connections through grant funds, the Safe Routes to School federal grant. I mean, we've done 3,000, 4,000, I can't remember how many lineal feet of sidewalks. That's a lot of sidewalks that weren't there before that are now connected. I don't know that we'll be able to invest that much ever again, but the idea is that we're chipping away at that. So I don't have a good answer for you, Steve, as far as the percentage of city that is covered, but the plan exists, it'll be updated, and it'll be discussed each year by the city council through the budgeting process on where the priority lies for making future connections.
I'd try this one more time. I brought it up last time. Listen to all of us. The only thing we all seem to, and I can't guarantee it, but I think it's a 7-0 vote, is we're all for sidewalks in a whole block long or a project.
Yes.
So I don't see why we can't live with that. Absolutely. And be unified and you know, fill in the gaps, but let's don't create any more gaps. We got gaps to fill in now.
That's exactly
so
the point.
I don't think this is that difficult. We just aren't standing back and looking at it that way. But, you know.
I think one of the reasons that P&Z brought this forward is because there have been a number of council-approved site plans where sidewalks were required, but at a future date. And there was no date to be determined. Mm-hmm. And so we look at the Nazarene Church, we look at Crystal Heights. There were a couple of those. And then there were, in fact, some that had them removed or taken out. And so I think there were some inconsistencies there that P&Z felt, okay, if we're making these approvals or recommendations to you as a group, there's nothing in the code that just says it's required. And so we're getting inconsistent application of this. So why not just codify it? Why not make it the city code and make it required for everybody? I think that was actually the original intent behind it and why commercial and industrial were in fact, the priority because we were trying to require them through site plan process anyway.
Well, I'd have to ask Wendell. I'm not putting words in his mouth, but the way I understood it, they were wanting us to tell them. They were getting tired of doing it and then having us change it, and I agreed with that. I mean, but if we give them a direction, they won't have to do that. We just need a direction we all agree on. And like I said, we all seem to agree on doing a project that's at least a block long or longer and forget the spot building.
It was my understanding that Crystal Heights had planned to put sidewalks in. They figured they was going to have to.
Oh, I thought that
and this just up the street, we have new sidewalks. And right in between, we've got three sidewalks to nowhere out of five properties. We could have connected. That would have been a good place to put this in. And we failed to do so.
If I remember correctly, the city council approved the site plan with a stipulation that would say they'd put them in at a future date.
Mm-hmm. It went to planning and zoning first.
I understand that, but council approved it that way.
I don't think so.
Okay. So, we have our motion and second to send it to P&Z. Mm-hmm. Roll call, please.
Yates?
Yes.
Burnett?
We're sending it to P&Z with a recommendation, is that what we're doing?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
That's the motion, yes.
They've got every right to be able to say we don't think so.
Yeah.
And send their recommendation back.
All right. Yes.
Caligiuri?
Yeah.
Jimenez?
Yes.
Moore?
Yes.
Persteig?
Yes.
Walling?
Yes.
Okay.
I'm worried.
That passes.
Housing.
Give them something to do
again. We'll see what happens.
Okay. Okay, item F. This is to consider an ordinance amending the Oskaloosa Municipal Code, Section 15.04.035, International Building Code, International Mechanical Code, and International Residential Code Amendments. This will be the first reading. According to Oskaloosa Municipal Code, Section 15.04.030, the City of Oskaloosa has adopted and enforces the International Residential Code 2009 edition. The IRC requires frost protection for all residential buildings and structures with few exceptions. One exception states that frost protection of freestanding accessory structures with an area of 600 square feet or less of light frame construction with an eave height of 10 feet or less shall not be required. At the December 19, 2016 meeting, the City Council voted 6 yes to 1 no, directing the city manager to revise the frostbooting requirements governed by the IRC. The direction provided during the discussion was to allow for an exemption from frostbooting requirements for accessory structures when a design professional has provided approval. The attached ordinance that's proposed in here includes the following language. Quote, frostbooting requirements for accessory structures may be waived by the building official if plans and specifications prepared and designed by an engineer or architect licensed by the state to practice as such are submitted. Such plans and specs shall sufficiently demonstrate the ability of the proposed structure to address frost heaving for the intended use of the structure and shall conform to the provisions of this chapter and of all applicable laws, ordinances, rules, regulations, and orders. Now, staff is not recommending approval of this item. Staff is recommending that City Council postpone the action on this item until the issues regarding frost footings can be more fully researched. Staff has contacted engineering firms about the possibility of providing consulting services to help develop a professional recommendation on frost footing requirements and has also been in contact with many other cities around the state about their approach to the issue. A full professional recommendation on this issue may take several weeks to develop. I'll open it up if there's anyone who wants to make a motion.
I'll make a motion. We approve it.
Okay. I'll second it.
And a second from Joe. Okay. Discussion.
What are you approving?
This language right here.
The language we got right here.
Which is? You don't need frost footings if you get an industrial guy saying it's okay without them.
With the engineer stamp, is that what you're saying?
Right.
You approve it with the stamp.
With the stamp.
I guess the question I have is I would like to hear comments from staff on what is driving their recommendation. I'd like to talk a little more detail on what you've learned over the last 2 weeks that would want you to make that recommendation.
And sure, it'll be a blend between Andrew and I responding on this. First and foremost, I would say we don't recommend approval of the item, period, regardless of additional study work or nothing, because, or anything, I guess is probably the proper grammar there. I think tweaking the code, I'll start this way. We haven't received a number of complaints about this issue in the 7.5 years I've been here. So the first, there have been two issues with frost footings. One was a contractor doing work. We had some issues with permit issuance and all that, but it wasn't because they did or didn't have to put the frost footings in. This is the only time that it's been an issue brought to my attention. So this isn't like the burning issue that has been beaten down the door since I've been here. So I'll preface it with that. I think the second part of my recommendation would be if this becomes the standard where we have the code in place, we make a modification that says, okay, fine, an engineer can stamp it, and more than just a piece of paper with a stamp, it's going to have to be plans, it'd be as-built in some particular circumstance, it'd have to be an as-built, stamped, all of that. What's the next code section that we're going to make an exception to and have another exception? And I think that becomes a little bit problematic. It's kind of a slippery slope. And I'm not saying that the code is perfect by any means. The codes that we're using are, I would consider, best practices. They're put together by a group of individuals who sit on these boards, who generally know about building codes, their area of expertise, they weigh in and say, this is the best practice. Again, they're not perfect, we know that, but I'd say in most instances, they work just fine. So I think that for at least those couple of reasons, I would say that's the strongest argument I could make against taking any action on it. Andrew did contact other communities. Maybe share that information.
Sure. We've reached out through the Iowa Association of Building Officials, received more than a dozen responses back as far as what communities have done. And across the state, it varies. I can't say what a full survey of, you know, all municipalities in the state, but majority that we've researched have the existing frost footing square footage in place. There are many that have adjusted it, have some sort of exception language, have increased the amount, some up to 700 square feet, some up to 1,000 square feet. Many times those greater allowances also have specific recommendations to the construction of the floating slab, so that there would be additional rebar and support within that. And that all makes sense. And I guess that kind of gets back to the recommendation that council does want to go this way. We just haven't, frankly, at the time to get into the details of what would be most appropriate necessarily here. I've reached out to a couple of engineering firms, and actually shortly before coming up here, got an email back with a few comments from one engineering firm about the possibility of providing some consulting services, but haven't entered into anything real specific with them yet.
I find it interesting that there's so many variations at all these communities on this issue. It tells me that maybe this is the first one we've dealt with 7.5 years, but maybe a lot of communities have dealt with it, or they'd all have told us in these 12 we contacted, we just follow the code. So that kind of tells me that there may be some real issues out there across our state that there are some differences that maybe we do need to look at it.
It's so. Not the first time. We did this with Sprinkler.
Yeah.
And there's some deep rooted into this, and I don't want to give you my spiel every time we talk about it, but they may be best practices, but code books are written by people that do it for a living, and they do it every 3 years, and they're not going to not write, they aren't going to lessen it, they're going to increase it every time. And our country's being penalized by some of this, okay? But in this case, it's the fact that, and it muddies the water because we have a project out there in the wings, okay? A tool shed, you know? I've said before, I've built many of tool sheds, I've built garages on floating slabs, no heat. I mean, and I keep using the word common sense, but everybody keeps telling me, Tom, you gotta quit talking about common sense, it's gotta be black and white. I mean, and that's not just Michael saying that. But there is some common sense. It has to be open for that common sense to prevail when needed, but still give staff, because they deserve to have guidelines. So, you know, I don't have a problem with this one. And I'm not gonna be voting on everything, but I strongly urge us, when it comes up again, to adopt the codes when they roll around 3 years. We've had a couple of brief conversations. I don't know who's got the time to do it, but you gotta go through that book and go, does this make sense?
Or are we gonna adopt
it? We're running into these same kind of problems downtown, trying to rebuild downtown. I just came back from Washington, D.C. and Virginia. Those buildings are all 300 plus years old. And I stood and watched construction projects. They take the fronts and they restore them. The fronts are the original ones that were there the day they were built. And they get by with it. And I'm telling you what, they got regulation. But somebody's looking at what's going on. We want these buildings to stay. I mean, you go in, they got totally new mechanical in them. But they still look original. I mean, there is some common sense in this world. And I was surprised to see it out east, because to me, they don't have a lot of common sense.
Wow.
But in watching them rebuild those, what do you call the houses? Row houses. You know, they're doing it.
support everything you say. It's just, I want to know what the costs are out there too. And I don't know that we could handle some of the costs that would go along with that, but.
Cost, help me with the cost.
The cost of living there and some of the things that they do.
Oh, well, no, yeah.
So, I think it all needs to be looked at. I think you and I are on the same page on this.
But I missed, I didn't get that out, but the new codes say you can't do it. But, you know, even Achilles and Mike, they came up with another code that helps us on the older buildings, and that was good. But it took a little digging in to find out that, hey, that there is another way to get this done. So, I mean, this isn't just this one instance. To me, it's a process to have the ability and common sense. Like I said, it does muddy the waters because we've got this project out in the wings. And I'm not giving that any credence. I'm just saying, I believe in it, that you have to have some common sense and you have to be able to do some things.
And I guess the only further comment I would have is, Michael, you and I talked about this several weeks ago, is to me, this is a good opportunity to create some of that flexibility, create some of that common sense without spending any more of your resources on it, without spending any more dollars on it. And so it's an opportunity to create common sense and also allow us to move on without tying up more of our staff on it, because I think we would all say that we've probably spent more time on it now than we want to. So I think if an individual wants to go to this length and he can get a reputable professional firm to do what's needed, I don't have a big concern with it, and it allows our community to move on to more important things, personally. Should I just have you guys spending your time on that?
No exposure to us when we have that signed off piece of paper and something happens someday, maybe. I'm not worried about it, this kind of a structure, but we do exceptions and we have a signed off, because that's what this is saying, essentially.
So I mean, we've had some discussion about what would be acceptable. You know, again, we're talking about stamp plans that would be recorded. And so, again, they have to be.
Well, wouldn't that be part of that?
That would be part of this, yeah. That's so what this
that's
would
the
be.
Details. I see more details, but when they come with a approved plan by an engineer or architect, all those other things will be there on that. On those documents, I would think.
Yeah, so I think that would limit the liability. But again, I think the idea is to protect the future home buyer. I mean, that's a lot of, well, again, codes are, you heard from Jason Van Alsdall about, codes are in place to protect, you know, the people that are either living there now or tomorrow or the neighbors. And so the idea is that we want something that could be on record through perpetuity, honestly, for that property. So whatever it is, the plans would need to be recorded, and it either, if it's an existing structure, we'd have to have as-builts that are stamped. If it's a new construction, it would be plans that are designed and stamped. And again, who are we to say at this point if they would work or not? I think that's the idea behind having the engineer design and stamp it. So this is definitely an alternative and allows us to move on.
So the exemption for the stamps is just for frost footings, it's not for any other piece of construction, part of construction?
No. It's just for this particular section of code.
Tom, you mentioned that you don't want to vote on every one of these, but what's to keep another? If I'm a builder and listening to this, I'm bringing you more examples of where I want some exceptions made.
I can't stop them from bringing them to us.
It's just like,
but, you know. So I'm not going to have an ear for everything. I'm in the construction business. I mean, we're going to loosen some things up so things fall down. This is a small building on a floating slab, no heat. It won't fall down.
No. That's fine.
I'm not sure that's
I'm not answer. Worried about the building. I'm worried about the precedent you set, because now you tell everybody, okay, if you don't like the law, just come talk to us and we may change it for you.
That's common sense.
Well, that should have happened.
Your thought process is good.
Yeah. This should have happened when we adopted the IPC code. My opinion, when you adopt something, you want to review that code and see what exemptions you're going to do on it before you really adopt the code. That makes sense? Just like the sprinkler and anything else. It's a long process. Go through all that.
Any further comments? Okay, the motion and second is to pass the ordinance as written with the cross-border requirements in there. Roll call, please.
Barnett?
No.
Caligari?
Yes.
Jimenez?
Yes.
Moore?
Yes.
Persay?
Yes.
Walling?
Yes.
Yates?
Yes.
Okay, that passes. Okay, finishing up. Item 8 is reports from city staff, city manager.
Mayor, council, I have in the agenda packet updates on some of the demolition efforts that have been taking forever, but that's the process. Again, we've had to shift some of the work here, but we're trying to get these back up to the forefront. 603 A Avenue East, you might recall about a year ago, that property was sold and transferred to a local builder. That property was pledged to be demolished by now, actually December 21st, if I remember correctly. Would have been 1 year, and that was the date that was pledged. We've been working with that individual to firm up a timeline. He's pulled a permit, he's lined up a contractor. Ideally, the thing will be down and will no longer be a nuisance to the community by spring.
Mike, if I can add to that too. Number one, you may have noticed if you've driven down the street within the last week, I saw an end loader in the front yard where they were disconnecting the water line on that. He has indicated to me he has the demolition fellow lined up and he envisions having it down within the next 3 weeks, depending on the weather.
So this week's not going to help him. This week's not going to help him much.
No.
Also along A Avenue, 703 A Avenue East, we've had that property since June of 2016. This process has taken a lot longer, but we've been trying to be cautious about how we approach the demolition. We've had some court issues there as well, but the property did become ours in June, and we have had to have some asbestos testing done, have that work back. There is a need to mitigate, and we have received demolition quotes. We're trying to get one more. Again, the idea would be that could come down as soon as possible. We have money in the budget specifically set aside for demolition. So that property, again, my hope would be by spring, give or take a month or so, would be down and, again, no longer a nuisance to the community. 115 Fifth Avenue West, which is the DeCook property, or formerly the DeCook property, that obviously is blight at its worst or best. We've had that property is a disaster. It's the extent of asbestos is substantial, I guess is probably the easiest way of putting it. So we're evaluating options as to whether or not we would mitigate or do an engineered demolition, which is you just basically put everything into a pile and remove it all as contaminated. So we're working on getting results for the mitigation and then demolition there as well. I can essentially guarantee you we don't have money in the budget to pay for that. It'll be something that we will have to work through in the budget process. So more work to be done there. But that was a property that we acquired in March of 2016. Again, the process takes a long time if we're the ones doing the demolition, and why we always try to encourage other people to do it.
Is that the white apartment house on the corner?
On the corner,
yes. Yeah. Yep, about a block off of Market. The other property that we have is 612 Fifth Avenue West. It's a smaller property. There are a couple other homes in that particular stretch of road that will be targets of ours as far as we'll be visiting them to encourage improvement. But this particular one we acquired, again, through a company, an investment company. We've owned that since February of 2016, and quite frankly, we didn't get around to selling it because when we did the transfer between Terry Anderson and ultimately Mr. Durande, the council said we need to bid these out. And so we did not get around to that. We don't have a policy for how to bid those out, and so we haven't done that. The idea is that we will have, like I mentioned this before, the policy in front of you within the next month or so, give or take. And then once that policy is adopted, then we can move forward with accepting sealed bids on that particular property. So we are trying to move these things forward, but as other priorities and needs arise, kind of having to work through that. So just wanted to give you an update on those two, or on those four properties.
Thank you. Thanks, Mike. Anything else?
No.
Okay. City clerk, anything?
No, sir, thank you.
City attorney, anything?
Nothing, thank you.
Okay. City council members, Joe, how about we start with you?
Nothing.
Okay, Aaron?
I got a call just before the meeting tonight on the corner of North H and B Avenue West. Somebody ran over a sewer cap or something, and then we've got a big hole there now. A lot of cement busted up, so you might want to check that out. Somebody could fall into our sewer. We don't want that to happen. That's all I got.
What?
Would that be inflow or infiltration? Scotty?
No, thank you.
He's so skinny there. Nothing right now, sir. Thank you.
Doug?
Nothing tonight, sir.
Okay, Steve?
I wanted to congratulate the alley. It's called the Urban Placemaking category, but they were given a statewide award. So kudos to Sherry Vavra, Ann Brower, Teresa Grayheck, Karen Hafner, and Deb Beach for getting our community noticed statewide. Thank you.
Well, you can't have enough of that.
That's awesome. Yep.
Okay, that's it. I've got nothing else to add. So with that, we have a motion to adjourn.
So move.
Oh, yes. Eggs and issues. That will start up again. It is going to be on Saturday morning at Smoky Row, 8:30 on January 14th. It is going to be focusing on local issues. And so, as it has been in the past, that tends to be a pretty spirited conversation. So at this point, I guess I don't know for sure what the slate is beyond myself. So hopefully there will be others assisting to draw a crowd, because I'm not so sure I could do it.
We'll be there to ask them.
So yes, I would encourage everyone to come. Coffee will be free, and it'll probably be a cool enough morning that it'll taste pretty darn good. So with that, do we have a motion to adjourn?
Second.
Okay. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
We're adjourned.